morning, good morning, good morning. Welcome to Rockin Country Church. We're about to get our worship started. You know, I need that. I need it every day. Gentlemen, if you'll remove your hats, we're going to go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we thank you for another day to come together to worship you, to lift up your holy name, for you're worthy of all praise. We thank you for Jesus who died on the cross to reconcile us to you, Father God, after he was raised on the third day, that now sits at your right hand interceding and loving us. Father God, we pray that anyone who doesn't know Jesus today would come to know him through the music and through the message that's preached and anointed by you. Father God, I ask that we would decrease as you increase, and that the Holy Spirit would move in this place in a way that we've never seen before, that we've never felt before. We know that we all need you. That's why we're here. Sometimes we don't know just how much we need you, but you love us always. We pray that this music would just be glorifying to you. That's why we're here, Father God, for you and nothing else. We love you and we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Oh, yeah? Was that the remix?
My darkest night will turn to day, where the soul of man never dies. No Santa Fe farewells, there will be no tear dimmed eyes, where all is peace and joy and love, and the soul of man never dies.
Never dies.
Country tattoos when I came to this church. So I just want y'all to know that.
She needed to learn one or two.
I'm just telling you.
A sinner now saved, blood washed by the Lamb. My brother's a king, the son of I am. Sometimes I forget to whom I belong. Then the sweet spirit cries, my child, he's still on the throne. He's still on the throne.
Wrong.
It is well with my soul.
It is well with my soul.
Let the stormy winds blow.
Stormy winds blow.
I'm reminded today. Thank God I am saved. Salvation's sweet song.
While the ages roll on,
he's still on the throne.
He's still on the throne.
Old Satan's got power, and sometimes I'm weak. At times I give up, and he walks over me. Then someone comes by with words loud and strong. Arise, my child, it is I. And I'm still on the throne. He's still on the throne.
He's still on the throne.
So what could be wrong?
Nothing wrong.
It is well with my soul.
It's well with my soul.
Let the stormy winds blow.
The stormy winds blow.
And I'm reminded today.
I'm reminded today.
Thank God I am saved.
Thank God I am saved.
Song. While the ages roll on, he's still on the throne.
He's still on the throne.
Salvation's sweet song.
Salvation's sweet song.
Salvation's sweet song.
He's still on the throne.
Salvation's sweet song. While the ages roll on, he's still on the throne. He's still on the throne.
Yes, he is. Yes, he is.
Hey, wild child, sit down. That's my grandbaby. I can't help it. She's full. She hadn't had much. She's naturally high-spirited.
I'm just a poor wayfaring stranger, traveling through this world of woe, where there's no sickness, no toil nor danger, in that bright land to which I go. I'm going there to see my father. He said he'd meet me when I come. Oh Lord, I'm just a going over Jordan. I'm just a going over home. No dark clouds will gather around me. Well, I know my way is hard and steep, but beauteous fields, they rise before me, where God's redeemed, their vigils keep. I'm going there to see my mother. She said she'd meet me when I come. Oh Lord, I'm just to go when over Jordan. Well, I'm just to go.
It was clear we both knew we sang it. Thinking about you.
Y'all like to make me cry before I come up here.
That's all. No, baby. I see this fall. Passing the buck.
You know, the music means so much to me. Gets me going. Okay. Do we have any first-time visitors today? If we do, please. Oh, I see a hand in the very back. I see two hands.
And
keep your hands up.
Back.
I see three hands. Okay. Back in the very back, back there, Jason.
And there's one back here, too.
There's two back in the back.
Two of them back there. They're on both sides of the building, honey.
That's just a little something put together by the ladies' ministry. The most important thing that's in there is a visitor's card and an ink pen. I would love for you to fill out that visitor's card with that new ink pen and drop it in the black mailbox, just so that we'll know that you were here and it was a blessing having you. If you've been coming to Rockin' Country Church and would like to make it your home, we would love to have you. There's a form on the back table. You fill it out and also drop it in that famous black mailbox, and Pastor Woody will get in touch with you. We have Bible study 2 days a week here on Tuesday mornings at
10:45.
And Wednesday night,
6:45.
They're both awesome studies. Completely different, but both awesome. If you want to learn the Bible, you need to come to Bible study. Tuesday morning at
10:45.
And Wednesday night,
6:45.
They are.
You learned to clap hands right, Johnny.
Yeah, he tries to throw me off every time.
Time is running out on getting your tickets for the bus to Harvest America. We really need to get the bus filled up and paid. It's $20 with guaranteed seating. I think they drop you right at the front, so you don't have to do a whole lot of walking. But if you're interested in going, get with Mr. Bill or Pastor Woody. I know Bill's here. I've seen him. But and get the $20 to them so that we can get a good head count of who all's going. It's an awesome, awesome experience. So if you think you would like to go, please do that. May 5th is our women's ministry meeting here at the church at 10:45. Miss Terry says be sure and bring your Bible. And I'm looking forward. Miss Barbara has something on the women of the Bible, the women that are not so nice. So I'm looking forward to this one. So it's May 5th at 10:45 here at the church. May 6th, we're having our monthly luncheon. It'll be Mexican theme. So there's a sign-up sheet on the back table. If you'll put your name on there and what you're bringing, that way we'll have an idea of what everybody's got, and we make sure we have plenty of food for everybody. Our newsletter is rockincountrychurch.org. There's all sorts of information on there. So Mr. Larry does a great job of doing our newsletter and stuff like that. So if you have any questions, just go on our website there and you can find most anything you need there. Here at Rockin' Country Church, we do not pass a hat, boot, or plate, but as the Lord leads you to give, we ask that you put it in the black mailbox also. The children's ministry is looking for some part-time help. If you think you might be good helping with the kids, then you might get with Miss Terry and let her know. She'd appreciate any help she can get. And we're going to start something new. It's going to be a prayer warriors texting. So if you know of someone that needs prayers, you can send Mr. Jack a text or Pastor Woody a text, and they'll send them out for everyone that wants on it. I don't have it on the back table yet, but I'll try to get it typed up this week. But that other letter, I haven't put it out yet because I haven't typed it yet. I'm falling behind on my job. You want to fire me?
I don't think so.
But I'll try to get it done.
You're
Saturday. I'm working all this week, so I can't do it this week. So we may have to work on something else there. But anyway, it's going to be good and informative, and it'll all be done by text. So, Miss Kathy wants to talk for a minute. And, you know, I can't get no money from anybody. I tried charging Kathy. Bill, you don't pay no more. Tammy's not here. I can't get money from anybody.
I just wanted to speak to everybody real quick about our readers. You know, if you come in every Sunday, there's someone there to hand out the bulletins and give you a big hug, greet you because we're happy you're here. I didn't get it done today, but I'm going to put a sign-up sheet back there next week because we need more people to volunteer to greet. You just have to be here by 9:15 with a smile on. And very rewarding, but our list is pretty skimpy, and then when people are sick at the last minute and don't make the end, we've got to figure out what to do. Couples are welcome, husbands and wives, you know, or two girls, two ladies want to be out there and do it together, that's fine too. So I'll have a table back there next week, please pray about it and sign up. Thank you.
Miss Donna? Yes, ma'am. Now, if you use a mic, I really do charge. Is the green one turned on, Jack? There's the green one here.
Allergies, boy.
Can you get it? Maybe.
This is the last song I made to be in.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay.
This is the last song.
All right. Guess what this is? Blood drive, May the 12th. May the 12th. It's going to be at the library in Seven Points again. We need signups. Let me tell you, the Carter Blood Center is so grateful for all of us turning out. It's amazing what this little community does as far as restocking the blood supplies. As I've told you before, blood cannot be duplicated. Only God creates that. And so we need to give the gift of life. And there's a lot that can give. There's a lot that cannot give. If you're able to, count it a blessing and a joy that you're able to help other people. That's such a small thing. I don't like to get stuck anymore than anybody else. But you know what? It's only for a minute. And then, you know, at one time I couldn't give and I missed giving. And the Lord healed my body and made it possible for me to give again. Amen. I'm very grateful for that. And I counted a joy and a blessing to be able to do that. So May the 12th, I think I'll put a sign-up sheet on the back table. That seems to work pretty well. Or you can just come to me personally and tell me there. It'll be from 9 to 12:30, so there's like every 15 minutes, you know, there'll be a slot. So if you have a specific time that you want to come, just let me know and I'll pencil you in so that there won't be a long wait or anything. Last month we had two buses for this area, which was awesome. So y'all try and participate. Also, those of you that ordered the eating healthy food sacks, they're in. Some of you have already picked them up. Does anybody not remember that you ordered? I do have a list. Okay, if you don't know, just get with me. I did not put the names on them because I was running behind. But anyway, some have already picked them up, but everybody's prepaid for them, so it's just picking them up. And I appreciate the participation. The next month, it will be on the 19th of May, I believe, and I'll be announcing that ahead of time. Of course, you have to pay in advance. My pockets are not deep, so I appreciate all y'all are doing. Next Saturday is the family and friends CPR. If anyone else wants to go that has not signed up, if you'll let me know, it's $5. That gives you the booklet that you keep and a card that you can carry in your wallet, but it also teaches you the CPR that can save a life as well. So if you're interested in that, let me know as soon as possible so that we can get the literature ordered for you. I appreciate it. God bless y'all.
Very good. On the very back page, I've added a few people. Miss Deanne asked me to put little Violet on here. She's 1 year old and she's in liver failure. So we want to make sure that we lift Miss Violet up. Patricia and Timothy lost a child this week. Timothy lost his daughter. So we want to make sure that we lift up Patricia and Timothy. Miss Barbara's son, James, we want to lift him up. And Mr. Kevin for health. So we all know that God answers prayers. So
amen.
We want to... He knows our every need, but it doesn't hurt for more than one person to pray.
Amen.
So I ask, gentlemen, that you remove your hats and lay your hands on the prayer requests. Our most gracious Heavenly Father, we come to you today with so much love in our hearts, and we give you all the praise and the glory. We thank you for your loving mercy and grace. I ask that you lift up everyone on this prayer list. Wrap your loving arms around them and heal them of whatever they may need. I ask that you take care of all of our homeless and our hungry and all of our first responders. Whoever wears a uniform, Father God, I pray that you send them home safe today. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Yeah.
Wrigley lived in that white house down the street where I grew up. Mama used to send me over with things. We struck a friendship up. I spent a few long summers out on his old porch swing. He was in the war, went in the Navy. Lost his wife, lost his baby. I broke down and asked him one time, how you keep from going crazy? He said, I'll see my wife and son in just a little while. I asked him what he meant. Looked at me and smiled, said, I raise my hands, I bow my head. I'm finding more and more truth in the words written and read. They tell me that there's more to life than just what I can see. Oh, I believe. Later, I was off at college, talking to Mom on the phone one night, getting all caught up on the happenings, the ins and outs of the small town life. She said, oh, by the way, son, old man Wrigley's died. Later on that night, there thinking back, I thought about a couple long lost summers. I didn't know whether to cry or laugh. If there was ever anybody deserved a ticket to the other side, it would be that sweet old man who looked me in the eye, said, I raise my hands, I bow my head. Finding more and more truth in the words written and read. They tell me that there's more to life than just what I can see. Oh, I can't quote the book, the chapter or the verse, but you can't tell me it all ends in a slow ride in a hearse. You know I'm more convinced, the longer that I live, no, this can't be, no, this can't be, no, this can't be all there is. I raise my hands, bow my head. I'm finding more and more truth in the words written and read. They tell me that just what I can see, I believe. Oh, I believe.
Two grandkids for sale. And I got $5 in my pocket. If anybody will take them, I'll give them the $5. Oh, it's all good. They're just kids. I want to talk to you. As you can tell, I'm a little raspy this morning. It is what it is, and so we'll just deal with it, right? But I want to talk to you about a couple of things. Last night, we had karaoke. And this is the last night. Last night was the last night that we're going to do it for a while until we get more participation. So we're trying to come up with things for the church to do, and we just haven't had a good turnout. You missed a great karaoke last night, though. We had three people singing with us last night that has never got up and sung before, and they were awesome, absolutely awesome. We had a great time. So you really missed out. But anyway, it's just how it goes sometimes. But if you want to do something, we're looking maybe for maybe a movie night or something like that, you know, something else to do in the church. So if you have any suggestions, just let us know and we'll talk about them, all right? We have an audit today. So do we have our four audit people here today? Raise your hands, please. Let's make sure you're here. All right, we have our four audit people, so we'll be doing an audit today. That'll be after services, of course. She mentioned briefly Harvest America. And we're getting that bus reserved. We're going to have a bus. We're going to go out there in a bus. And that bus is going to guarantee us a seat inside the stadium. So if you want to go, it is $20 a seat. If you drive out there, it's $20 to drive out there and park. All right. So if you want to go and not have to pay the parking, you know, just hook up with myself or Bill. Bill's back in the back there. We're collecting that money now so that we can get this process going. So if you want to go to Harvest America on June the 10th, we will be leaving here at 2 o'clock on that Sunday, right after church. 2 o'clock, we will be leaving here. If you're here, great. If you're not, then it'll cost you another $20 to park out there. Say again?
What time?
It is over with. It starts at actually 5:30. They say it goes from 6 to 8. They're starting at 30 minutes early, so it'll finish up at 8 o'clock. Now, however long that takes us to get back to the bus, et cetera, et cetera. So I'm presuming that we'll be back here probably around 11 o'clock. By the time we get everything all said and done, probably about 11 o'clock. All right? Now, just in case y'all didn't know it, this week is a special week. This is what we call National Secretaries Week. Wednesday is National Secretaries Day. So if you please, Miss Myra, Miss Edie, and Miss Laurie, will you please come to the front? Yes, I called your names. Please come to the front. These three ladies here do an awful lot for you guys that we don't realize. Come here, right in front, please. Right up front. Right up front. These three ladies do an awful lot behind the scenes all through the week, day and night, that you guys don't realize. That pamphlet that you have in your hand, it's taken care of by these ladies. Our books, which are impeccably kept, and the IRS says that, you know, we have the best books there is. These ladies do that. Your tithes and your offerings, they keep the records of it. Everything that this church does could not be done. This church could not exist without these three ladies here. And they work very hard, very diligently, and very committed to working for God and supporting His church. So being Secretary's Week, you guys come on. Being Secretary's Week, we would like to present our secretaries with a small token of appreciation, but I guarantee you, your words to them will be worth more than we could ever give them. So if you see them during the day today, please thank them for all that they do for us every day. They work every day.
All right. I can cry twice on Sunday.
Well, we have a little bouquet for you ladies, but we also have a card. We also have a card and a little gift certificate in there. All right. So give these ladies a hand. Amen. I thank each and every one of y'all.
I have to say something.
Well, sure.
I never in my life wanted to be at a small church. I wanted to be at a big church. Why do you have to do anything except show up on Saturday and get my card punched?
Right.
Let alone did I ever think I'd be counting money.
Yeah.
I mean, I did that post office, but, you know, that's all for somebody else. And I'm really good with somebody else's money. I mean, I really am, because I'm as tired as, I mean, I want to know exactly what you did, and if you had to pay taxes and we have a card you didn't have to, but supposed to, you don't get paid for that. You just bought the taxes. I'm sorry, but we've got a card, not supposed to pay taxes. And it is an honor and a privilege to work with these two ladies, and thank you, Lord, for giving me a small church.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you, sister. Thank you, sister. Appreciate it. God bless you, ladies. Thank you, ladies, for all you do. So again, as you see them during the day here, just recognize them because they work hard and they do a lot of work to keep our small church going. All right? All right, with that, let's go ahead and lift up our ministry today and our teaching today, and then we will get started. We'll dismiss the kiddos. So, guys, if you'll remove your hats, please. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for this day. We thank you, Lord, that we can come into your house and worship you, and that's why we're here, Lord. We're here as your children to come together as one and to worship you, our Lord and our God. And we thank you for being who you are. We thank you for being our lives. We thank you for being a part of our lives and for letting us do this. We give you all the praise and the glory, Lord, and we ask that today's message be your message, not mine, not Miss Terry's, not anyone else's, Lord, but let it be yours. Let it search out and seek the hearts and the souls and spirits of those who hear your word today, so that they may come to know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. Oh, we thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for all you do for us each and every day. And we thank you, Lord, for these ladies who help us daily. Lord, we lift them up to you, and we ask that you continue to bless them. In Jesus' name we ask. Amen? Amen. Amen. Let's dismiss the kiddos. Sorry, I'm a little raspy today. I think it'll probably come and go, but it is, believe me, better than it was yesterday. Last night, I tried to do a little bit of the karaoke, because even though it comes out pretty, as Pappy would say, yeah, I can sing real good. I just tear it up when it comes out, you know? And last night, it was pretty bad, so I enjoyed listening to, I'm going to say their name, Miss Beverly and Brother Ted and... Yeah, they were singing last night. I got pictures to prove it. And it was great. We had a very good time. But anyway, let's get on with today's teaching. You know, during these stressful times, many of us are under, things that happen around us. And we wonder, well, why does all this stuff have to happen? Why does it just seem to keep happening sometimes? Why do I not get a break? Well, we do get breaks. We just don't realize them sometimes because the things that do happen in our lives are so detrimental to us that it seems to magnify itself to the point to where it's larger than it actually is. Now, I say it's larger than it actually is. It is huge in your life, no doubt about that. However, your life is much more than just your disasters and your hard times. Much, much more than your disasters and your hard times. We ask, why, God? Why do you let this happen? So everything happens, good or bad, because God is in control. Now, do we believe God is in control of all things? Well, you may think he's not before I get through today, but I'm going to prove to you that he is, all right? Because sometimes we think that, God, why did you let this happen? God, why did you let that happen? We couldn't have a loving God if he lets these things happen. But we've got to understand, God is in control.
Amen.
And he will always be in control. Always. Always. Well, if that's the case, then why do these things happen? We're going to talk about that today. God is a good God, and good things come from God. First, let's understand that God is in control because he is the creator of all that is. So in other words, you wouldn't even be here if he wasn't in control. You say, well, what do you mean by that? Well, he gives us life itself. Life itself. Our fathers and our mothers have many seeds inside of them. We know what we're talking about here. But at one particular time, at one particular moment, when your mother and your father got together, she released a seed and he released a seed, a particular seed and another particular seed. Those two came together and made you. Well, what's so special about that? Well, if it had been another seed, then it had been your brother or your sister. It would not have been you. You see, God selected that seed in your mother at that particular moment, and that seed in your father at that particular moment, to put them together to create you. Because you are who he wants at this time of time. You are who he wants, not your brother, your sister. Now, he may have desires and needs for them, but I'm talking about you and me. You were made beautifully. You were created beautifully by the one who does control everything. At that right moment, those seeds came together because God controlled those seeds and released those seeds because he wanted you. He wanted you to be a part of his life. He is in control. Now, after we were given this life, this promise to mankind, it was passed on to us to this day. God promised over in Genesis 1 that man would inherit and man would dominate the world. Let's go over to Genesis 1. Genesis 1 and 23, and you are a part of mankind. Genesis 1. Genesis 1, verse 24. And God said, let the land produce living creatures, and according to their kinds, the livestock, the creatures that move along the ground, and the wild animals, each according to its kind. And it was so. You were made according to your kind because of God's plan. God made the wild animals according to their kinds, and the livestock according to their kind, and the creature, all the creatures that moved along the ground according to their kinds, and God saw that it was good. God created life, breathing life itself. Verse 26, then God said, let us make mankind, you and I, in our image, in our likeness, so that they might rule. So that they may rule over the fish in the sea, the birds in the air and sky, over the livestock and all the wild animals, and over all the creatures that move along the ground. So God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful and increase in number. Fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over it. God gave us all the things that he has made. This is on the sixth day. God created all living creatures on the sixth day. And he created us on the sixth day to rule over all of his kingdom, all that he has created. He ruled over the fish of the sea and the birds of the sky, over the living creatures that move on the ground. And God said, I gave you every seed-bearing plant on the face of the earth, of the whole earth, and every tree has fruit with seed in it. They will be yours for food. And all the beasts of the earth and all the birds of the sky, all the creatures that move along the ground, everything that has breath, everything that has breath of life in it, I give you every plant for food. And it was so. God saw that it all that he had made, and it was very good. And this was the evening, and there was morning, the sixth day. So on the sixth day, God created you and me, mankind, in order to rule over his earth that he created. This was all done in one day, one actual day. That's how powerful God is. He spoke it all to an existence, and it became. So is God in control? Yes, he is. God is in control. He is the creator of the world. And on the sixth day, he gave that world to us. He gave that world to us. Now, he couldn't go back on his word and take it back. Although he will try to help us all through the process of living our life. He will try to assist us in every way he can to try to make it a happy place like he wants it to be. He created the Garden of Eden in the very, very beginning so that we would have all that we would ever need and want. That we would never need anything. We would never want anything. It would all be provided for us. God gave it all to us. We are not the creator, but we are the created. In Genesis 2 and 7, if you just jump over to 2:7, it says, "Then the Lord formed the man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living being." Just to let you know, chapters 2, 4 through 25 is the detailed message of the sixth day of creation. So when you go through there and you say, "Oh, well, here he is creating Adam and Eve now. Well, I thought he already did." Well, he has. Adam and Eve are our forefathers and mother. All living beings, as far as human beings, are their earthly mother, if you will, came from Eve, and their earthly father is from Adam. They were the first man and woman of the earth. And God created them so that we could, later on down the line, so that we could be created in our mothers and fathers. He originally created life for his pleasure and enjoyment. He created life with no pain, sickness, anger, strife, jealousy. He created with to not have any lack, grief, sin, or death. And he gave it all to us. That was God's plan because God is in control. But we have to understand, he gave it to us to dominate over. So he didn't take it back. Now again, I said a little bit ago, he's tried to help us get it straightened out a couple of times. He gave it all to us so that we could feel that we were in control, that we were not self-sustaining, or that we could be self-sustaining like he is, because he created us like him. There is nothing that God needs to sustain himself. He is all that there is. And he created us to be the exact same way, to be self-sustaining, self-sufficient. But needless to say, we messed it up. Well, Adam did that, not me. But you're a part of Adam. And I am a part of Adam. So there's not a one of us that is perfect. There was one born of God and a woman that was made perfect. And that was, we're going to talk about that instance here in just a little bit. Of course, we know that's Jesus Christ. God has tried to get this world straight 7 times. He's done 7 different things. We're going to get to that in just a minute. And one of them, of course, was to send his son, Jesus Christ, as our Lord and our Savior. We messed it up. Why? Because we're not God. We don't make all the right choices. We don't have all the right answers. We don't know all there is to know. But we still have a life to live. If God had to live it for us, then why would we be? You see, if God didn't want us and didn't want to give us all the blessings that he does, there would be no reason for us to be here. If God didn't want a relationship between us and him, there would be no need for us to be here. But we are. It is our life he has given each of us to live, which puts him in total control, but is us in control of our lives. God is in total control, and he will never relinquish that total control. But he has given us the control over our lives. So we can live our life with a view of a hopeless ending, or we can live with a view of never-ending hope. We can live with a hopeless ending, or we can live with never-ending hope. we decide. The stated man, the stated smartest man that ever lived other than Christ himself was Solomon, King Solomon. It is said in the scriptures that he was the smartest man of all. He asked God one time, he says, God, would you bless me? And God said, sure. What do you want? What do you need? He says, I want wisdom. I want wisdom. Well, what is wisdom? Wisdom is knowing what you need to know when you need to know it. And he wanted wisdom. He didn't want riches. He didn't want a new Ford truck. No, he wouldn't even ask for a Dodge, but he didn't want a new Ford truck. But he wanted wisdom. Wisdom to make the right choices at the right time. And God gave him, it is said in Scripture, God gave him all the wisdom that he needed. And he was the smartest, other than Christ himself, he was the smartest man who ever lived. Now, I don't really understand that, because if you read about Solomon, he had 700 wives and 300 concubines, or 300 close girlfriends, let's say. I don't understand where the smartness comes in on that.
I can't understand why you're insane.
But Scripture tells us, and so I have to believe that he was the smartest man to ever live. Now, you can look at it this way, and this is the way I thought about it. When, if you had 700 wives, then they would be so busy dealing with themselves, you wouldn't have to deal with them. They would be so busy. Did you see what she did? Did you see what she did? Well, you know, she said this about me, and bah, 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 bah. And so he just sat back here saying, okay. Just a thought. Life goes on until the one who is in control, which is God, says it is to stop or to change. The time has already happened four times. Four times in history it's already happened. And there will be a fifth, sixth, and seventh time. We're going to cover those if you want to write these down. In the beginning, before anything was, there was God. There was God, and there was Jesus Christ, not as Jesus, but Jesus and the Holy Spirit. It says over in Genesis 1 there that we will make him in our image. That's plural. So God was there before anything else was. The three, the triune God. That was the first one. God was. The second one, he made the heavens and the earth and all that is in it. The third one was the flood. The flood, when God tried to cleanse the earth to get it reestablished the way he wants it. Everything, every living, breathing creature, except for those in the ark, passed away. So God did his best to cleanse the earth. The fourth one is the church age. The church age is the age that we are in now. And that is when Christ came. It's the age of grace. God, through Jesus Christ, showing his love for us by giving us the undeserving love of his Son, Jesus Christ. This is the church age. This is the fourth time that God tried to get the earth going in the right direction. We're still in that age. The fifth will be the age of wrath. The age of wrath is whenever the rapture is going to come, and it will, and the church, the body of Christ, will be lifted up into heaven to be with him, and then the tribulation period will happen. There'll be a 7-year period, and that's the wrath age. God will try to get it straightened out again. The sixth will be the kingdom age, when Jesus rules for 1,000 years. He will come back and he will rule for 1,000 years, trying to get the earth, the world, the mankind that God created to come to him and realize he is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. That'll be the sixth. The seventh is whenever God is going to rest again. He rested on the seventh day. He will rest again on the seventh age. The seventh age is the eternal age. The eternal age is coming. And that's when God will wipe out every sickness, every illness, every sin, every disease, every infirmity. And there will be nothing but pure bliss on the earth. And Jesus will be king. That time is coming. And that is the eternal rest that we all look forward to as Christians. To where there will be no more sickness or pain, agony, woes and worries, stress, anger, strife, grief. It'll be nothing but pure bliss in the presence of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ forever, forever. And that's a long, long time. But during that time, during this time, while we are still here, life goes on. Let's go over to Ecclesiastes, written by Solomon. Ecclesiastes, it's after Proverbs and Psalms. And before Song of Solomon, we're going to go to Ecclesiastes 2 and 24. Ecclesiastes 2 and 24. It's right after Songs, then Proverbs, then Ecclesiastes. Everybody there? Anybody not there? I didn't ask if anybody needed a Bible. We got Bibles if anybody needs one. I asked you to follow along. I think we're good to go. Most everybody knows that we need to bring our Bibles to church, right? We also need to open them up at home, right? Amen. We don't shake the dust off on Sunday morning, right? Amen. All right, Ecclesiastes 2 and 24. A person can do nothing better than to eat and drink, find satisfaction in their toil, in their work, in their life. Now, if you read that, you think, oh my gosh. So I'm just supposed to eat, drink, and be merry, right? Well, to a degree, what he's saying there is you need to enjoy life. Enjoy the life God has given you. It goes on to say, this too, I see, is from the hand of God, because it's been given to you. But look at that next line. For without him, who can eat or find enjoyment? There is no joy without knowing Jesus Christ. There is no joy without knowing you're saved. There is no joy without knowing you have an eternal future. Otherwise, you just eat, drink, and die. But we don't have to. To the person who pleases him, God gives wisdom, knowledge, and happiness. But to the sinner, he gives the task of gathering and storing of wealth to hand it over to one who pleases God. In other words, we're going to win in the end. We're going to be victorious. During this life, there's going to be tough times, but we're going to win in the end. Chapter 3. We use this a lot of times at funerals because people request it. But this is life. Solomon wrote this to tell us this is how life is. This is how simple life is. There's a time for everything, a season for every activity under the heavens. See, plural again, plural heavens. There's three heavens. A time to be born and a time to die. A time to plant, a time to uproot. A time to kill and a time to heal. A time to tear down, a time to build. A time to weep, a time to laugh. A time to mourn, a time to dance. A time to scatter stones and a time to gather them. A time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. A time to reach and a time to give up. A time to keep the time and a time to throw away. A time to tear and a time to mend. A time to be silent and a time to speak. A time to love and a time to hate. A time of war and a time of peace. What do workers gain from their toil? I have seen the burden God has laid on the human race. The burden that God has laid on the human race. What do you think that burden might be? That burden is life itself. You see, we have to go through all these different seasons, all these different times, in order to experience life. If you don't experience all these things, how are you going to know what life is about? These things are going to come. Jesus says, you will have troubles in your life. But be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world. Amen. So we're going to have these ups and downs through life. We don't like them. They hurt our hearts. They hurt our souls. They depress our spirit. But we have to know and realize, as children of God, the Most High God that created all things, we win in the end. But we have to get through these times. And Jesus says, you will have these times. You will have these seasons. But you'll get through them. Psalms 23, we use it quite often at funerals and stuff. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil, for thy rod and thy staff comfort me. In other words, God is with you, helping you through that valley of the shadow of death. God is always with you. He never leaves you, never forsakes you. He will always be there for you. But we seem to turn our back on Him when we go through these things. We seem to say, God, you must hate me. God, what did I do that was so terribly bad for you to cause these things to happen? He gave us dominion over the earth, and then we turned it over to Satan. That's over in Genesis 3. We turned it over to the evil one. That's why these bad things happen in our lives. Not because of God, because we turned it over to Satan. Satan causes these bad things. If you want to get ticked off at somebody, then by God, get ticked off at Satan. Amen. Get angry at who caused the issues, the situations. He's a punk. You tell him to get out of your life, get out of your family, get out of your work. And you do it in the name of Jesus, and he has to flee.
Amen.
But if you blame God, do you think Satan is going to leave? Shoot, no. He's sitting there going, yeah, I want another one. See, when we get mad at something that has caused us such grief and strife and broke our hearts so bad, we want to blame God. Well, God, you're supposed to be in control. God gave you dominion. Amen. He hasn't taken it back. He will, when Jesus comes back and rules for eternity, he will have taken it back then. Not until then. Until then, we have to deal with the issues of life. We have to. Well, I don't want to deal with them. Well, then you just go ahead and die. Because you're going to have them. You're going to have them. Jesus tells us plainly here in Ecclesiastes 3, you're going to have these seasons in your life. They exist, but they actually exist to make you stronger. Well, Lord, I don't want to get stronger that way. You don't have a choice. He's in control. See, he's going to put things on your heart. He's going to put things on your life. Or actually, he's going to allow Satan to, let's say. That you feel as though you can't bear. But you do. And you will. Not to try to bring up anything or any ill feelings or anything, but you think back some of the times that you've been through in your life. Some of the really hard times. Many of you have fought cancer diligently. And won. Some of our people have fought cancer and lost. Amen, sister. Many of you have been through divorces and separations, and you thought, well, I'll never get through this, but you made it through. Many of you have been through the death of a loved one, and you thought, my world is over. It's not. You see, it's appointed to one time for a person to pass. Every one of us are going to die at some point in time, and not all at the same time. These are the seasons of life. There's a time to be born and there's a time to die. These are the seasons of life that we're going to go through. They're going to hurt. They're going to be painful. They're going to
they're going to take you down to almost nothing. But we have to realize we win in the end. And one that is very, very comforting is that we know that if they are brothers and sisters in Christ, the moment that they pass, they're in the presence of Christ. And that's where we say as Christians, we want to be, right? That's where we want to be in the end. That is the winning gold. That is the winner's circle, is to be in the presence of God. They just got there a little before you. But I'm going to get there too, and so will you. But I have to go through these seasons. You have to go through these seasons. Lord, it hurts too bad. Then call on His name, because He is the comforter. He is the comforter. God can give you the comfort to get you through. Because we must understand that these seasons are going to come. Now, you know, you think, oh, I wanted to come in here, a good sermon is going to lift me up and get me going, right? Well, you know, sometimes we have to tell what the facts are. And there's been, we've lost Diane here recently. There's been some other people who have lost loved ones here recently. There's been other things happen in our lives that we didn't like, we didn't want, that hurt so deep that we wonder, well, God, why are you doing this to me? First and foremost, God is not doing it.
That's right.
Satan is doing it. That's why you get mad at Satan. Well, God, why did you let this happen? God has to let things happen. Do you realize that if you got everything you ever wanted, what would you want? What would you want? See, if God blessed you with everything that you wanted, you wouldn't even want God. You would not want God. Why? Because you wouldn't need Him. We have to realize that life is tough, but Jesus is our strength. Jesus is our strength. It's not just that He gives us strength, He is our strength. He is our strength. I think I left off on 9. I'm going to go to 11. He has made everything beautiful in its time. Everything beautiful in its time. You say, well, how can death be beautiful? I just explained it a moment ago. When I die, I'm going to be in the presence of God. That's a beautiful thing. I welcome it. Not that I want it to happen today or tomorrow, but at some point in time, I have an appointed time, and it will happen. And I welcome that time, because God says that my time on earth is done. He has finished with me working here, and then I get to be in the presence of Christ. So that is beautiful to me. He has also set eternity in the human heart, yet no one can fathom what God has done from the beginning to the end. We don't understand it all the time, but we have to understand just how much God does love us and how much God does want to be with us. In the very, very beginning, He created the Garden of Eden to be a perfect place for us to live. And then He gave it to us to take care of, and we messed it up. He has given us life itself today. Are we messing it up, or are we getting it the way it should be? You see, it's up to you how your life goes. Things are going to happen in your life that you cannot control. How are you going to react to them? That's what you have control over. Are you going to thank God for the things that He does give you? And are you going to curse Satan for the things that he takes away? We have a tendency to do the opposite. Which we should thank God for the breath of life itself. God is in control. And when He says it is finished, it will be finished. And when He says enough is enough, it will be enough. We're giving a life to live for God's controlled plan. How we view this life will either encourage us and others, or it will discourage us and others. There will be ups and downs. There will be losses and gains. There will be sickness and health. There will be riches and poverty. There will be love and hate. There will be life and death. We must choose daily how to live our lives, with the hopeless end or with a never-ending hope. In Genesis 1:7, where we were a minute ago, it said that God formed man from the dust, and then he breathed into him the breath of life. Over Ecclesiastes 12, flip over there real quick. Ecclesiastes 12, verse 7. Ecclesiastes 12, verse 7. And the dust returns to the ground it came from, but the spirit returns to God who gave it. Amen. The spirit returns to God who gave it. He created mankind. He says, let's create mankind in our image. And then he formed the body of man out of dust. My body, your body, everybody's body is going to go back to dust until the rapture comes. Then we won't have to die. He will take us to heaven to be with him, and we will receive our heavenly bodies. But in the meantime, there will be death in our existence. In our lives, there will be problems. There will be issues. There will be hurt. There will be sorrow. And our tears will fall all night long, but in the morning, joy will come. Hallelujah. Joy will come. People often ask me two questions. How am I going to get through the tragedies of this life? And the second one is why do these things have to happen? Well, I'm going to answer the second one first. Why do they happen? Because sin is in the world, and the wages of sin is death. Death comes with mourning and sorrow. But all will pass from this life, each and every one of us at some point in time. All will pass from this life to death, and at some point, the dust will return to the dust. And that's life on earth. That's life that we are here living today. It's going to happen. The second question is how do we get through these life tragedies? By knowing the promises of God. Amen. The end of the book. The faith in our Savior Jesus that we win in the end. For without God in our life will end in further torment in eternity, for eternity. But with God, through faith in Christ, who overcame death, we will live in eternal bliss. Eternal bliss. In the presence of the one who were in the beginning and who said, let us create man in our image. And they will all, these three will also be there to the very, very end. Which actually there will be no end. You see, eternity is forever. It does not end. It has no ending. And Jesus says, and I will be with you until the ends of time. I look forward to that. Without Jesus, though, you have no hope. Just a hopeless ending. But with him, he is our never-ending hope. Let's go to 2 Peter. 1 Peter. 1 Peter 1. In 2 Peter, though, you can mark this down if you want to. In 2 Peter 3, 4, the scripture says, life will go on as it has before until God, who is in control, will say, it's time to renew this world. Now, that's paraphrased. But over in 2 Peter, it says, God is in control, and until he says, it is time to renew this world, life will go on as it always has. That means there will be troubles, there will be trials, there will be sorrows, there will be mourning, there will be sin, there will be death. But over in 1 Peter 1, verse 3, it says, "Praise be to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead." Through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. "And into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. This inheritance is kept in heaven for you." He doesn't say that it's on the earth for you. He says it's kept in heaven for you. Now, there will be a new heaven and a new earth at some point in time. And that will be right here on this earth. Amen. After God cleanses it the last time. You can read about that if you want to over in 2 Peter 3. He explains it, he lays it out perfectly. Verse 5, "Who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time." In the last time of your life and in the last time of the earth age, the church age which we are now in. Because at some point in time, this church age is going to end. When Jesus, you hear that loud trumpet, and you look to the east, and you see Christ in the skies, calling up his church. The dead in Christ will rise first, then us who are still alive and remain will be called up to meet them with Christ in the air. And we will be taken home to be with Jesus. That is our hope. That is what we look forward to. Verse 6, "In all this, you greatly rejoice." Don't live downtrodden, because your future is already laid out. The plan is already there. God has total control. He knows exactly what's going to happen, when it's going to happen. And his word says that you will be in heaven with him eternally if you choose his son, Jesus Christ. However, though now for a little while you may have had to suffer grief in all kinds of trials, these have come so that the proven genuineness of your faith is of great worth than gold, which perishes even though refined by fire, may result in praise, glory, and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Though you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and are filled with the inexpressible and glorious joy. For you are receiving the end results of your faith, the salvation of your souls. The salvation of your souls. Your soul will live forever. Your spirit. Your spirit being will live forever. You have two choices as to where to live it. Without Christ or with Christ. Without Christ, there's darkness and weeping of teeth. There's nothing but hell and torment. But with Christ, there's nothing but eternal bliss. You have the hope now. And that hope is Christ. You can rejoice in that hope, or you can live an ending hope. Or have a hopeless ending, realizing that without Christ, there is no future other than torment, pain, sorrow. You think you're going through it now? Hell is not a place of happiness. Hell is not a place of being with others. Hell is not a place of joy. But heaven is total bliss. For eternity. Total bliss for eternity. I know this is not a, "Oh man, you just really lifted me up today" type message. But if you think about it, it should be. It should be. Why? Because I've told you, just as Jesus has told you, you will have troubles. So when they come, expect them. People ask me sometimes, "Well, why do you always try to have a, or why do you always seem to have a pretty positive attitude about things? Why do you feel as though, you know, everything's going to be okay?" Because it is.
That's right.
See, I know My wife actually asked me the other day. She says, well, why do you put up with all this stuff? I said, because I know that someday all this stuff will be over. And I get to be with Jesus. I know I win in the end. I know I am victorious. I'm going to lose some battles, but I have already won the war. Amen. I have already won the war. So yes, I rejoice. I rejoice in knowing my Jesus Christ, my Lord and my Savior. Because he's going to, at some point in time, I love John 14, 1 through 3. He says, do not let your hearts be troubled. Do not worry. Do not be sorrowful. You believe God, believe me also. In my Father's house are many mansions, and I've already got yours all set up and ready to go. And when it's your time, and it will be your time, I'm going to come back and get you and take you to be with me so that where I am, you will also be. That is God's promise to you. That you have eternal life with him. And that eternal life, there will be no more pain, no more sorrow, no more sickness, no more illness, no more grieving, no more tears.
Amen.
Except tears of joy.
Thank you, Lord. You
will be so overcome with the joy that the tears of joy are just going to flow from your spirit. Not tears of sorrow. And one of the things that I'm really looking forward to, I don't know a lot of y'all don't know this, some of you do. I've never known a grandparent, okay? I mean, I try to be grandparents to my knotheads, and I try to be a good grandparent to them and let them know how much I love them. I knew my grandfather, one of my grandfathers, for just a very, very short period of time until he died. And he's a tough dude, man. I remember one time I got off a bus at our house instead of his house. Man, all of a sudden I saw his car pull up in the driveway. And he said, boy, bend over that bed. And I mean, he wore me out. I never got off the wrong bus stop again. But he loved me. Real quick story. He would go, he lived across town. It would be like living in Athens. And me living in Kemp. And he would drive across town with his lawnmower and his gas in the back of his car so that I could use it to go cut grass and make me money. Not paying back. I cut yards for $40 a yard. I mean, $1 a yard. Try that, Gary. $1 a yard with a borrowed lawnmower, and he provided the gas. And that's how I bought my first bicycle. When I was about eight or 9 years old. He loved me. And I'll never forget that stuff. Those times that I used to sit in his chair and he used to tell me maybe were adult stories and some of them were kid stories, but he told me stories of his life. How in World War I he was in the Navy. How he was a firefighter. How he broke his leg whenever there was too many firemen on a wooden ladder and it fell and broke. And to the day he died, he was suffering with the lasting effects of a busted leg. He told me all the stories of all the girlfriends that he had and walking to school and not getting to school on time for whatever reasons. And just all these kind of things. I enjoyed what little time I had with my grandfather, which was really only about 3 years that I can remember. But I'm going to see him someday. Because I know he's in heaven. I know he loved, because he talked to me about God. He wasn't a churchgoer, but he knew God. He knew Jesus. And I'm going to see him someday. And then I'm going to see my brothers and sister that my mom lost before they were born. One of them was born and lived 9 days old. I'm going to see those. I'm going to see all the people that loved me and I loved them that have gone to be with the Lord. Every one of them. And you'll do the same thing. Because they're with Christ now, waiting on you. Waiting on you to come and see them once again. The people that Diane's family, last weekend, I think it was, whenever it was, that we celebrated her memorial. The people came up afterwards, several people from our church spoke, 2 weeks ago, I guess it was. Several people came up from our church and spoke on her behalf. And I had family members come up to me afterwards and go, you know, used to, if you broke out a Bible, she would say, you need to go put that up. Because we don't have that stuff around me. But she is in heaven today because she came to know Jesus Christ. You see, you don't have to wait until the last minute. You don't have to be perfect. You don't have to get everything right. But there is one thing you have to do. You have to receive Christ as your Lord. Because there is no way to the Father except through Him. He is the only way, the truth, and the life. And no one comes to the Father except through Him. So if you want to see those loved ones again, if you want those loved ones of yours to see you again, then you better start walking the walk and talking the talk. Because Christ is real. Satan is real. And while you're on this earth, you are going to go through trials and tribulations and hard times. But Jesus says, I have overcome the world. I have overcome the world. And because He lives, we too shall live. You can overcome this problems, situations, issues, whatever they happen to be, you can overcome. You are a winner. You are a victor, not a victim. You are a winner with Christ because Christ has overcome the world. And I hope you've done the same thing. I hope you have chosen to receive Christ as your Lord. Because you cannot get to heaven without Him. Oh, well, He'll let me in when I get there. No, He won't. You can pay all your tithe, all your money to the church. You can be the Mr. and Mrs. Christian, all you want. But if you don't have Jesus Christ as your Lord, as your Savior, you don't get through the gate. Plain and simple. But to get that ticket, to get through that gate, there's only one way, and that's to say, Jesus, Jesus, be my Lord, be my Savior. Come into my life. Guide and direct me. Help me. And He'll be there, just like that. And He will be your strength to get through whatever it is. Whatever it is. Guys, let's pray. Father God, if there's anybody here today who does not know Jesus as their Lord, as their Savior, you're not guaranteed tomorrow. You're not guaranteed next week. But you are guaranteed, once you pass from this life, you are guaranteed an eternity in total bliss in the presence of God Himself, who was there in the beginning and who is there in the end. He's just waiting on you. So if you have not received Christ as your Lord, as your Savior, which is your only way into heaven, I ask you to make that choice today. You must mean it in your heart. Just say, Dear Jesus, I ask you to come into my heart, come into my life, be my Lord and be my Savior. Guide and direct me so that I'm never alone from this day forward. And I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Well, I'm sorry it's not an uplifting, joyful teaching today, but I teach whatever the Lord gives me, and He gave that to me this morning. Well, I just want you to know there is not a hopeless ending. There is an ending of hope, and that's Jesus Christ. And He is for you. He is for you. He loves you. If anybody needs prayer, let us pray for you. Please come forward and let us pray for you. Let's all rise and give God praise.
Well, I could count a million times people asking me how I can praise you after all that I've gone through. The question just amazes me. Could circumstances possibly change who I forever am in you? My life has changed long before these rainy days. It's never really ever crossed my mind to turn my back on you, Lord, my only shelter from the storm. But instead, I draw closer through these times. So I pray, bring me joy. Bring the chance to be free. Bring me anything that brings you glory. And I know there'll be days when this life brings me pain. But if that's what it takes to praise you, Jesus, bring rain. I am yours regardless of the clouds that may loom above, because you are much greater than my pain. You who made a way for me by suffering your destiny. So tell me, what's a little rain? So I pray, joy, bring me peace, bring the chance to be free, bring me anything that brings you glory. And I know there'll be days when this life brings me pain, but if that's what it takes to praise you, Jesus, bring the rain. Is the Lord God Almighty? Is the Lord God Almighty? And I'll forever sing, holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty.
It's the Lord God Almighty. Singing, holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. It's the Lord God Almighty. It's the Lord God Almighty. Is the Lord God Almighty? Almighty is the Lord God Almighty.
And everybody singing, holy, 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 holy is the Lord God Almighty. Is the Lord God Almighty.
Amen.
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 All right, thanks all.
Well, have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in His grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed?
Are you washed
in the blood?
In the blood?
In the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Lay aside your garments that are stained with sin, and be washed in the blood of the Lamb. There's a fountain flowing for the soul unclean. Be washed in the blood of the Lamb.
Are you washed
in the blood?
In the blood?
In the soul cleansing blood? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Some glad morning when this life is over, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore.
God bless you all.